Where's Porter Davis? There he is. Friends and countrymen, we've reached the time where we're all going to kind of focus together on some of the same ideas. I really hate to interrupt all this good fellowship, but there'll be more to come. We're going to begin with a word of prayer. Former Representative Porter Davis will lead us. If you'd all stand at this time, then immediately following that, Paul Kelly will lead us in the flag salute.
Father, I thank you for bringing all these people here together tonight, all these people that have it in their hearts to take into their bosom the problems that we're facing and this crisis that we're in, and are willing to put themselves on the line, both the elected representatives that we have and the grassroots activists. Father, I pray during this time that you would give your people that are in this room great discernment to see what's going on, that you give us understanding so that we can understand the times, Lord. I pray that you'd give us knowledge so we can go deeper into those things that we need to know, and that you'd give us a great deal of motivation and courage to get the job done, Lord. I pray blessings on all of the elected officials that are here tonight, that you would keep them protected from the forces, the wickedness that surround that Capitol building, Lord. And I pray that you'd protect their families and protect everybody here. Pray these things in Jesus' holy name. Amen.
Attention to college and salute. Pledge
allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation.
Thank you. Please be seated. Okay, continue eating. I know a lot of you are already done because the line was so long. Some of you just sat down. We won't mind if there's things stuck in your teeth. Just enjoy yourself. And there's not going to be a break in this program. You don't have to get permission. If you have to go, just go. It's back there. There's not going to be an intermission. We're just going to keep going. So just make yourself comfortable. In fact, I went ahead and made sure to bring the hard drink and the drugs right here into the room for us. Baptists, relax. It's Christian approved. Talking about caffeine and sugar are here in the room. Just feel free to go get coffee. We're going to leave this back door cracked open. You could sneak out and go get more cobbler and sneak back in and have it with your coffee. So just be comfortable and we'll just keep talking. That's fine. They put out more cake. Mrs. Wesselhoff says there's more cake out there, so it's totally fine to go get more drugs. Here's the agenda for this evening. I'm going to make a few introductory remarks, then we're going to hear from our keynote speaker who's going to deliver our charge to the legislators. Then Charlie Meadows and I are going to give out the awards. We'll have those in three sections. We have some special awards, then our traditional best of awards, and then finally our best of the best awards, and those are Charlie's overall conservatives that have worked so hard year in and year out to receive our highest awards. So I want to recognize a few folks in the audience here tonight before we get underway. First of all, I want to recognize the hard work that many of you freshman legislators put in to get yourselves elected. Freshman legislators here tonight, stand up, wave, so we can recognize you. These guys have already hit the ground running in the first week. They're seeing what it's like to get in the trenches and do battle for bills that are both principled and unprincipled and see what the challenges are ahead of them. I saw Dr. Everett Piper in here. Where's Dr. Piper from Oklahoma Wesleyan University? He may be the first college president we've had. I want to recognize two gentlemen that have worked hard for decades now in the grassroots movement for conservatism. That's Ron McWhirter and Steve Baez. Gentlemen, stand up. These are the editors of the Oklahoma Constitution newspaper. Here's Ron over here. Where's Steve? He's sitting down. Okay. Ron and Steve have been at it for some 38 years. The Oklahoma Constitution's been publishing the conservative index. That's what tells us when these guys stay on the reservation and when they get off the reservation. And it is one of the most important duties that we have at OCPAC is to help with that index, choosing the bills, making sure that that index actually does reflect true conservative values. And we're so thankful for them. I want to thank our members. our donors, our elephant providers, our rhino hunters, the ones who put money into the pack willingly, not because their cell phone went off, so that we can get these great freshmen elected, to be the next remnant, to be the replacement of Dan and Sally and Jason and these other champions as they retire and are term limited. We couldn't do it without you, and so I thank you. This is not a fundraising banquet. A lot of banquets you go to are a fundraising banquet, and they lock the door, and you have to fill out a form and all that. But I thought, what the heck? I have a captive audience. So I did at least put our membership forms on the table. Whether you donate or not, take the membership form because it has our mission statement in it. It tells a short story about what we're about, and I want you to know what we're about. So put that in your pocket, guys. Right here is where it goes, next to the cell phone that should be turned off, and take that with you tonight. And if you like what you experience and what you hear, consider donating to the PAC. Finally, I want to recognize our leadership team. This is not a one-man show. If you all would stand up, please. Jill Byers. Jill, Stephanie West, Bob Donahue right here in the back, Susan Holmes, Susan Goodman. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen, for making this pack what it is. Thank you. I would like to recognize someone else on our leadership team if I could, but he may not be here with us. You see, an operation like this takes spies, I mean volunteers, all over the state watching the news, watching what's happening and keeping up on things. So the person who is assigned to watch the Oklahoman newspaper every day saw this obituary last week. If you can't read that, let me blow it up. Charlie Meadows, age 64, died January 22nd. So it would be so nice to recognize Charlie. Fortunately, it turns out that rumors of his demise are greatly exaggerated. The man is here, Charlie Meadows, the founder of OCPAC. You used to get calls for that. You won't get calls for him anymore, unless they're collection calls for debts left behind. You know, Charlie is fond of talking about this being the oldest pack like this in the state, the most influential pack like this in the state, and he will tell you that it's going on 26 years old now. I think it might be much older than that. In fact, we've uncovered some archaeological evidence that OCPAC is much older than that, maybe a couple hundred years old, which makes you wonder, how old is this guy really? Okay, tell me if you don't think this wasn't maybe a 17th, 18th century member of OCPAC. He said, "You may perhaps hear the cunning and promise-breaking of King Henry I, called policy by some people, diplomacy by others. Neither of these fine words will in the least mean that it was true, and nothing that is not true can possibly be good." Charles Dickens, that's right. So this idea that there is a standard, that there's truth, goes back a whole lot further than 26 years, doesn't it? Well, here at OCPAC, we believe that this isn't about right and wrong. This isn't about, I mean, it's not about Republicans and Democrats. It's not about liberal versus progressive. It really is about right and wrong. So not right-wing ideology, but correct, righteous ideology. If we can point to a policy or a statute or a law or a bill and say, that is based on theft, on covetousness, on coercion, on things that violate God's law, then it should be no law at all, and we should be fighting to tear it down, not put it into our law. I want to talk now for a few minutes about the people that are here in this room. We recognized a few, but let's talk about all of us and who we are. The grassroots movement in Oklahoma, the conservative base. Who are we and why are we here tonight? You see, there's a lot of different Indian tribes in Oklahoma, and they have different issues that they care passionately about. They're focused like a laser beam on solving certain problems. Let's talk for a minute about some of those tribes and who they are and what they have in common. First of all, you have tribes of people that are focused on life more than anything else. Folks like me involved with Oklahomans United for Life. You have abolitionist societies all over the state and now all over the country. You have the crisis pregnancy centers that are doing their work. All of these people are a part of that tribe. There's another tribe that's focused on self-defense. Because you know what? There is no right to life if you don't have a right to defend it. They're two sides of the same coin. And you can't defend life unless you're allowed to carry a weapon big enough to defend it. And that's where the Oklahoma Second Amendment Association comes in and the gun advocates come in. And they're focused on defending those rights in that tribe. There's a tribe that stands up for liberty. The people in that group look like the John Birch Society. They look like the GOP and other groups that are there watching to protect our civil liberties and our rights to property and the ability to own and control our own things. Because again, it's wrong to steal and it's wrong to covet under God's law. Then there are the uber liberty lovers who also want to protect our property. This is where you might see the 9/12 people, the Tea Partiers, the Libertarians, and we could throw the conspiracy theorists in there. A word about the conspiracy theorists. They're right. Then we have those focused on education. You've got ROPE, the education, freedom of choice in education advocates. You've got the homeschoolers, the homeschool movement, all focused on education and making sure that we decide what's best for our children, not the state. You have those focused on health. I saw many here tonight that are connected with the Vaccine and Health Choice PAC, and boy, didn't they make a stir at the Capitol this week. Because this is my body and it's my choice when it comes to health. You have the churches, you have the service clubs, the Rotary clubs, the Lions clubs, the instruments of God to fill in the gap in society when people are hurting and need help. You have those tribes. Now, I want to point out to you that I think when we look at these tribes of grassroots activists and conservatives in the state, there's a couple of things they all have in common. The first thing I notice they all have in common is OCPAC. Our members are their members. Their members are our members. We're together in this. And we function like a catalyst, a communication network, and a communication pipeline to have all these groups working together and helping each other. Because there's a connection in all of these issues. Which brings me to the second thing that they all have in common. And that's they all believe there's a right way and a wrong way to do things. There's man's way, which leads to destruction. And there's God's way that leads to blessing. And that's the other thing that holds all of these groups together. If you're a legislator here tonight and we have endorsed you or supported you, if you're a candidate here tonight and you've come and interviewed with our PAC, no doubt the first question we asked you was this one. Should there be a correlation between civil law and moral standards? This one is not an opinion question. There's a right and wrong answer. And the answer is yes. And of course, if you don't answer it correctly, you probably don't get our endorsement. And you probably didn't get the lecture talking about God's absolute universal moral standards that apply to everybody in every place at every time. And that what you do as a legislator working with civil law is only a small part of that. Because we don't need to legislate everything that's moral. But everything we do legislate had better be moral or it should be no law at all. And that's how we know. That's how we know what law should be. And when you get outside of that circle with your civil law, that's when you start losing points on the conservative index. That's when you lose our support. That's when you're not part of our tribe anymore. So stay with us. Stay in the unity of the tribes. Keep your policy principled, and we'll work together to make all of us have protection of our lives and our property. What's that, Charlie? You making wise remarks? I'm so glad you've lost your voice this evening. All right, so with that little bit of preparation, let me go ahead, and we've laid the groundwork. And we need to go ahead and introduce our speaker tonight who's going to deliver our charge to the legislators. Our speaker tonight is a graduate of Colorado Christian University and the University of Colorado. He and his wife, Lauren, have 9 children. If you were here last year, you might remember Matt Truella and his wife have 11 children. So are you thinking, is there some sort of test, like how many kids do you have to have to be a speaker at OCPAC? Yes, the minimum is 7. If God can create everything in 7, you have to create at least 7 children before you can be a guest speaker for us, okay? So they've got the nine kids. Here's what they've just recently done. They've just recently settled in Iowa. They picked Iowa because it's the middle of the country. It's kind of like our Interstate 40, only on the north side, right? They can get anywhere from there. But they just came off this 10-month tour visiting more than 40 states in the union, promoting his documentaries about communism. And we'll hear some about that tonight. Like many of us, he got involved in politics because he wanted to make a difference. He wanted to protect lives and property. And he felt like the sovereignty of the kingdom of God extends into every area. God is not schizophrenic. Religion and politics can go together. They're all part of his kingdom. And if men and women in the kingdom of God are not involved in politics, then we turn it over to Satan. And so he wanted to get involved. And he became a representative in the Idaho legislature. And then, like many of us, when he gets involved, he finds out just how corrupt it really is, how systematized the evil really is. And when he started digging into it, he started realizing that there are plans, that there is orchestration that is evil. And so as he retired from the legislature, he decided to make movies about that. And now he has basically become an award-winning filmmaker and a prophet and a tenacious lover of the truth, and wants to share some of that with us tonight. So please help me welcome Curtis Bowers.
Boy, I'm probably going to let you down after that introduction. Well, first of all, thank you for being here. Thank you for caring enough to spend some of your time getting involved in the OCPAC that's trying to make a difference in your state. Thank you for doing that. Those of you that are legislators here, thank you for being willing to put your name in the hat, to be willing to make the sacrifices necessary to engage the battle we are in for our country, is the reality of where we are. And so I just want to thank you for that. Now, most people are good at complaining about what politicians are doing, right? And those of you that are legislators, that's why we brought you here tonight. Okay, we're going to let you really have it. No, we're actually not. Our main purpose, and John's main purpose, and OCPAC, is to encourage you and to motivate you to be faithful with the tremendous responsibility you have been given. Okay, and you've been given that position by God. And so you have to take this seriously. You will give an account to him one day, face to face, for every single vote that you cast. Okay, and the things you chose to stand up and have courage and talk about, and the ones you cowered back and didn't. We all will, because God is God. And so I want to encourage you, which means to add courage. I want to help fill your courage tank to do the things that you should do. Now, when all of you first came to office, like when I did, you swore before God and man that you would uphold and defend the Constitution of the United States. You'd preserve, protect, and defend it from all enemies, foreign and domestic. Okay? If you take that oath that you swore seriously, it is a huge commitment. There's a lot going on in this country. And if you are not the most alert, the most prepared, the most ones with the most discernment to deceive the people that have an agenda and the people that are well-meaning, but still analyzing, are those different groups still preserving, protecting, and defending our Constitution? Are they misguided? Or are they evil? You have to have the discernment to do that. And if you're not willing to, you need to step down and help get someone in there that is willing to do that. Now, I have spent the last 10 years full-time studying the enemies within our country. It came to my attention as I was a representative that there's a lot going on here that I don't think is what I'm really seeing. They're behind-the-scenes things and stuff. So I started to study. And I can tell you this with complete confidence, that there are far more powerful and influential and wicked forces operating inside of our country than out. The threats from within are far worse than Red China or the former Soviet Union or any of those things. Those are threats, but they are nothing like the deceitful, wicked lies that are being taught our children, that are penetrating our culture at the core. And so, but we need to be up on those. If you aren't aware of these enemies and their agendas, how in the world can you protect us? You can't, because you won't know what the root of this tree is. You just see the branch of, oh, we're for saving the planet. Okay, well, who's not for that? So I'm for that. Instead of going, okay, sounds like a good thing, but let me follow down to where the root of this particular issue or this one came from and see who are the people involved. Is it bearing good fruit or bad fruit? Is it constitutional? And so many different things. I want to give you an example, something that opened my eyes. In 1992, I was in graduate school, and an older gentleman asked me to go to the University of California, Berkeley, to a meeting of the Communist Party USA. Why was he interested? I didn't know that much about those things at that time, but he said, hey, you know, in 1989, the Berlin Wall had come down, and in 1991, the Soviet Union had dissolved. Now, this was the summer of 92, 6 months later. And he goes, why are they having a meeting? He goes, would you go out there and just listen for 3 days and take notes? I'm just curious what they have to say, because the game's over. We won. Well, what was interesting, I went out there. And I'll just get into one issue alone. For 3 days, 12, 15 hours a day in breakout sessions, they covered many different things, but one of the main focusing things they talked about is how they were going to use, and this is 1992, they were going to use the environmental movement to destroy free enterprise in America. They went on for hours and hours how they're going to do it. They're going to regulate and control and tax to drive business out of America so it will collapse economically from within. And they talked about how they were going to destroy the families and on, but different things. But that was one area. Then when in 2008, I'm a representative, and environmental legislation started to come through my desk, and I got calls from businessmen saying, don't pass that bill. It's not helping the environment at all, but it's going to wreck my business. All of a sudden, my light went on. And I hadn't thought of that meeting in 16 years, but I thought, that's what those crazies were talking about at Berkeley. And so I started to pull back the curtain and study that movement. And I'll just give you one nugget on this, showing there is so much there. When something doesn't make sense, there's a reason why it doesn't make sense. But you have to dig in to know what it is. Here's just a foundational principle. As I started to study that movement then, because I thought, okay, I need to know what I'm talking about. If I'm going to say this isn't good, and they're going to call me, oh, you hate the planet or whatever, I need to have a defense of what I believe. So I started studying. And I'll give you this one nugget to stimulate your ability to go in and dig, find more. But see, the foundation of the entire environmental movement is what? What's the key thing? CO2 is a pollutant. I mean, that's the core thing. That's why we're changing everything we do throughout America. Why? Because we have to cut CO2 emissions. It's deadly, right? Well, you start studying this, I go, maybe I'm missing something. So I dug in and studied. Right now, the level of CO2 in the atmosphere worldwide is 425 parts per million, okay? That doesn't probably mean anything to you like it didn't to me, unless I knew, what are we shooting for? You know, what's the goal? What's the optimum CO2 level for everything that is green? If we're going to call our movement the green movement, we better be doing things to help what's green, right? Isn't that reasonable? So I dug in, and I found that the optimum CO2 level for everything that is green is 1,600 parts per million. We're at 1/4 of the optimum level for everything that is green to thrive and explode. And yet we have a movement calling itself the green movement, and it is doing everything in its power to cut the production of CO2, which in reality is fertilizer. It is plant food at its core. That's why greenhouse growers, they pump in CO2 into the greenhouses to double, triple, and quadruple the CO2. Because why? Every time you double CO2, plant growth efficiency goes up 35%. The same plant will produce 35% more fruit if you double CO2. And I started studying. I go, what are we doing here? So I started to pull back the curtain a little bit. And I found, oh, Who came up with this movement, and who are the people funding it, and who are the leaders speaking into this and trying to change the way we do everything? And another good question was, why are they against CO2 then? Since it's obviously a blessing to the planet, it is the single most vital element in our entire atmosphere, and we don't have near enough. But then I thought, well, because everything productive man does produces CO2, and we breathe it out even. So they needed a cause that would make us the very enemy of the planet. And the things we do that are productive, why? Because they don't want productivity. Productivity produces wealth. Wealth produces freedom, and they don't want that. They want dependency and enslavement and entitlements, so you have to vote for them because you want to keep getting your check. And as I dug in, and I don't have time to go into all the details of that, but I want one issue to see, we need to dig in. Another telltale sign was the Earth Charter, which is the new Ten Commandments for the 21st century. And it's being carried all over the world, and has been for years now, in an exact replica of the Ark of the Covenant. And they worship it and they pray to it. Those are the new Ten Commandments to create a sustainable world. Where I thought, where'd that come from? And I researched who wrote that. Guess who wrote the Earth Charter, which is going to govern the new civilization of the world from here on out? Mikhail Gorbachev, the former communist dictator of the Soviet Union. So this stuff, you dig in, you go, it's a lie. But they knew they have a great vehicle because everyone cares about clean air, clean water, and stewarding our resources. All of us do. But they're going to set the parameters of what that looks like to fit into their agenda of dismantling what we have in America. So that's just one area that, again, if you don't know what's going on, you'll be misled. When they come to you and beg, why aren't you standing up for the environment? And you don't have anything to say, they're going to destroy you. But if you can say, because I really am for the environment, and I realize the agenda of this Save the Planet movement is going to hurt the planet. It's not going to help it. So that's one thing. Another thing, if you don't know the Constitution inside and out, and what our founders' intentions were, how in the world can you fulfill your oath of office? How can, if you don't know what's in there, like most representatives know, and I know in Idaho, I was shocked. No one knew anything about anything, and they could prove it. I mean, from the governor on down, they just knew how to talk the conservative lingo because they knew Idahoans were conservative, and they didn't worry. They knew they're not going to pay attention to what we're doing anyway. We'll do whatever we want, whatever benefits us the most. And I know Oklahoma is similar to that in a way. It can be that way where you know the people are totally behind something, but they know, the politicians know, you're probably not paying attention to what they're doing anyway. So, but you got to know that. I mean, you need to know that the whole clout and power of the Constitution comes from the Declaration of Independence, where it was stated for the first time in world history by a government that the rights of mankind aren't a gift from government, they are a blessing from the hand of God. And that separated. And that's what made us different. I mean, the Constitution isn't what our rights are. Our rights do not come from the Constitution. Our rights come from God. The Constitution simply states that the chains that are to be put on government to help stop them from taking those rights from us. So if you're a representative, and I don't care if there's 10 mass shootings in a year in America, and everyone starts to say, we've got to eliminate the guns, you realize that's outside of our jurisdiction. God has given every man the right to defend his wife and his children. We cannot take that away. So that's not even an option. Or if they talk about changing the Constitution, say, the Constitution isn't the author of our rights. God is. Our founders just did the best they could to articulate the main areas they knew we would have a problem. They knew man would try to encroach on and destroy. And that's what they did. But if you don't know that, it's hard to stand in there and be tough and be direct and speak the truth if you don't have the defense of the truth with you. We have to know why we do the things we do. And we have to teach those to our children. Your job is to ensure life, liberty, and property for each individual person. Our society now is obsessed with the idea of pursuing a course where it's the good of the many outweigh the good of the few. That's Marxism. I've been studying it for 10 years. 10 years, that's all it is. America was never based on that. Our founders said we will never care about the good of the many or the collective. We are going to focus everything we do on one thing alone, protecting each individual person. Why? Because they are priceless, because they're made in God's image. And they knew if each individual person's taken care of, the collective will be just fine. And it's true. But Marxism and the liberal philosophies that are being taught our young people, no, we need to pursue a course where we're always concerned about what's best for the good of the many, and that always ends in slaughter of minorities and fringe groups that aren't being represented, and we cannot allow that. Now, life, what is life? It's our societies act like there's many definitions of it. Life is life, all life, from conception to death. It's life. You can't have, you legislators, I know they're going to come push on you and try to redefine. Life is life. When something is living and then it is not living, that a life has died. I don't care if it's one day after conception with a miscarriage or if it's at 95 years old when you have Alzheimer's and they say, he's not there anyway. Just, he's wasting oxygen. Just let him go. We protect all life, because it's out of a respect for our Creator who made us in His image. And that's why I don't care who you are or what you are, we stand for life. And life, the road we are on right now is so slippery. I'm going to tell you what you're going to see coming through in just the next few years across America. There's a professor at Stanford University who's been talking this, and he's starting to gain traction. He wants a woman to have the right to choose an abortion up to 2 years of age. In case you find, oh, this kid's not smart, or he's got health problems, we don't want him to be a burden to society, and it's starting to gain momentum. Because when you're coming from a secular humanist worldview that does not value life, you're like, oh, it's a Down syndrome baby, or he's not very smart, or he's sickly, he's going to be in bed his whole life. They're like, get rid of him, he's going to waste our money, because they don't value life. If you allow man to decide which life has value and which one doesn't, it's always going to start slipping. Like with Hitler and Stalin and Mao, they'll say, these people, unfit. These people, as long as they're productive, working hard for us, we'll let them live. The day they get old, get rid of them. Because then it becomes man deciding who has that right. Now on liberty, do you know, our definition of liberty or freedom is so castrated from our founders' intention when they talked about liberty. Liberty is not the freedom to do whatever you want. That's what our society has redefined. A young person, I'm free, I can do what I want. And our founders and God in the Bible were crystal clear on what man should be free to do. Only one thing. Man should be free to do what is right. And that is it. You are never free to do something that's wrong. That will destroy you. That will destroy society. It was, and our founders talked about that. And that's why they said we have to have a moral and religious people to be given this much freedom. Because if they're not moral and religious, the freedom will destroy them instead of be a blessing to them. And that's what we're seeing throughout our country today. It's not a blessing to our young people. It's not a blessing to the people that don't have character. It's destroying them. And us allowing them to do that is not loving our neighbor. When we allow them to be on a self-destructive course of indulgence and license to do what is evil. If you break God's laws, you will reap what you sow. And we're not teaching that like we should. Now, also on the last part of this, life, liberty, and property. We have such a limited definition of property. We act like, oh, it's my home, a piece of land I own or whatever. Our founders, when they spoke of property, It was our intellectual property. It was our beliefs. That's your personal property. And it cannot be defied. It's physical things, but it's also ideas. Under Marxism, no ideas are yours. If you have a good idea, the whole society will take it from you, and they will institute to make as much money as possible for the government or the dictatorship. In America, hundreds of years ago, we realized we need a patent system. Why? So each man can benefit from the ideas and his creativity like God would want him to. He would want him to be able to benefit from those things, his hard work and everything. Well, now we've changed everything. And that's why you as representatives, when a bill comes through that's making Hobby Lobby fund abortion for their employees or whatever, and they say, no, you're not protecting my property, my beliefs, my the things I hold dear. You're making me go against my conscience, which I cannot do. And we need to stand, and you representatives need to stand. That's who you're for, is the individual that needs that protection. Now, what's exciting about all of this is you in Oklahoma, if you were committed, if you were willing to sacrifice whatever necessary for the founding principles, which are really just biblical principles, and not back down or compromise or surrender, I think you could turn Oklahoma into the example for America. I really, really do. As I've been in 40 states in the last 12 months, speaking with so many different people, and they're all longing in their heart just for one state that would stand up, one state that would go back and start doing it the way we used to do it. You would have so many people. I would move here. I really would. I absolutely would. I'm not kidding. I would want to support that. I would want my children's businesses to be in that state. I would want to be, you know, paying taxes in that kind of state to be a part of something that's being done right instead of wastefully and wickedly. And so, but you can do Oklahoma like an Idaho. And I tried to convince them of that there, and they weren't interested. All they cared about is being reelected. They loved the name tag so much. Even the guys that I was right in line with on everything. I think some of them were born-again Christians. But they had been attracted to the position because of the title instead of because of the passion to stand for the truth. If you have that title because you're attracted to that, I ask you to step down. And you find someone. And I ask you to find someone that will do it out of duty. They don't really want to be there, but if it's their duty, they will stand up. And then they don't care if they're going to be reelected. They're like, praise the Lord if I get out of this place. It's hard faking it so long. I had just trouble being in there. I'm like, man, I just so much chit-chat of meaninglessness. You can only take so much. And it's like, yeah, it's over the top. But anyway, so now for that to happen, for Oklahoma to start going a different direction, back to the old ways, and the successful ways, you're going to have some opposition, obviously. And I was thinking, and I know what it's like to be represented. I know it's tough when every word out of your mouth gets twisted and turned and bashed, and it's on the headlines of the paper every time you stand for something that's right. But that's your position God's called you to, and you need to be willing to do that. But the main area that you're going to have a struggle, if you want to do this, is the fear of man. You cannot fear man. You must fear God and nothing else. And I know it's tough, but he can give you the courage to do that. I promise you he can. And he can do so much more than we ever ask or think. The media will rip you apart every time you stand for the truth. But you need to start wearing that as a badge of honor. I'll tell you this, you representatives that are in here, and I say this kindly because I've been in your position. If the media is not attacking you regularly, you are not doing the job you've been sent there to do. Another issue that is going to stand in your way is political correctness. That's one of the things I've seen as such a deadly threat to America. So when I was studying history and what's going on, I studied the roots of that. Well, it started in the early 30s by the Frankfurt School, a group of German intellectuals, and they called it, when it first started, they called it cultural Marxism. It's how to take a culture from a Judeo-Christian heritage to a Marxist belief system. But they realized we better not have the word Marxism. And after some of the slaughters in the Soviet Union, they changed. Let's call it political correctness. It's a way to be correct. Hitler did the same thing in Germany. It's putting off limits certain words, certain ways, so you cannot communicate clearly because you're not allowed to say that or you're not allowed to do that. And so it so hamstrings your speech. All of a sudden, people are not really communicating. They think they are. They're using words that we're familiar with, but they've changed the definitions. And so it starts to fragment society where it makes people more sitting ducks for propaganda or lies because people aren't really communicating. Well, so that's two of the areas I know that you're going to have to stand up and just be politically incorrect and proud of it because you're standing for your people you're representing. Don't you forget them either. I used to get so blasted. I just can't keep my mouth shut. So I just got blasted. I was on the headlines of the paper every day. But I'll tell you this. When I came home at night and I'd hit my voicemail, and there, I remember one time from one incident alone, I got 200 phone calls from people in my district, and only one was negative, of saying, we are so proud of you. You keep standing up. And when I got discouraged, I'm like, I want to get out of this thing. I'd go home and I saved about 100 of them, and I'd listen to them for a few minutes. Okay, that's why I'm down there. This old guy called up. He goes, we're so proud of you. He goes, don't let them grind you down there. And I said, I was so grateful for that encouragement. So, but remember those people. They're counting on you to be there to stand up because they can't. They have to work. They have to raise their family. So you're in their position. And if you start acting on your best interests instead of theirs, you're being deceitful to them. And so don't do that. Now, last thing here as I start wrapping up, a key thing too that I'm convicted in my heart is now is the time. Over the next 2 to 4 years is key. There has not been a major shift back to conservative principles since the last election, like some people are talking. It was the mercy of God that has allowed us to have another brief window to influence, to stand, and to be free and use that freedom for righteousness. And so it needs to happen now. It's not, well, in a few more terms I'll do that. It needs to happen now. Here's the reality. The progressive left, which works through the Democratic Party, is going to come back in 2 years with a vengeance. Don't you think they're gone away? They are strategizing 24/7. They are engaging. They're organizing. And they will be 10 times as deadly in the next election. The thing you have to remember is we are still losing 85 to 90% of our young people every generation through the educational system. They're numbered by 2020, the Democrats will have millions of more voters guaranteed because we allowed them to raise our children. So the time is now. You have to be active and you have to be prayerfully on your knees saying, God, what would you have me to do? What do you want me to do? And I beg you for specifics. What wall do I die on and stand on? Which one do I let go by the wayside? But we need to do that. It's worth it. Our children are worth it. Now, I'm going to close with a poem, if that's all right. Have I gone too long, John? Okay. And I tell you this poem. It's my favorite poem ever. But I tell it to you because it shows the battles we are fighting. Yes, maybe they're the worst they've been in our lifetime, but they are nothing new. All parents and every generation that has ever existed have had to decide, are my children worth the sacrifices I'm going to need to make to stand against the secular humanism of the world and raise them to fear God and love what is right and to hate what is evil? And some have said, nope, life's too busy. I'm going to let other people raise them. I'm going to go play golf. And other generations have said, yes, they are. I will do everything in my power till the day I die to stand for the truth so I in some way can hand to them not only the testimony of my life, but the action and the fruit of my life in maybe giving them a better situation than I had. And that's what we need to do. Well, this poem, it's by Rudyard Kipling. and it's called The Gods of the Copybook Headings. And this, what this poem is all about, everything I just talked about is in this poem, and it was written over 100 years ago, but it reads like it was written today. And the gods of the copybook headings, what those were, is in early American history when there was some education going on in the schools, every student had a little book called a copybook. And they would open it up, and on the top line of every page, there would be a proverb, a maxim of truth, like, you reap what you sow. And they would copy that little proverb over on all the lines of the page to learn their penmanship, but also by the time they copied that 25 times, that truth had sunk into their conscience and their soul. It was a very smart way to learn. So what Rudyard Kipling does in this film, he compares the gods of the copybook headings, the things of absolute truth no man can deny, that last throughout the ages. He compares those to the gods of the marketplace. Now, the gods of the marketplace are the things of man that always promise a lot, but they never quite deliver. They always seem to fold over time. And he compares them. He's like Father Time. He's watching throughout all the ages this comparison. And it's just a neat poem. As I pass through my incarnations in every age and race, I make my proper prostrations to the gods of the marketplace. Peering through reverent fingers, I watch them flourish and fall. But the gods of the copybook headings, I noticed outlasted them all. We were living in trees when they met us, and they showed us each in turn that water would certainly wet us and fire would certainly burn. But we found them lacking in uplift, vision, and breadth of mind. So we left them to teach the gorillas while we followed the march of mankind. We moved as the spirit listed. They never altered their pace, being neither cloud nor windborne like the gods of the marketplace. But they always caught up with our progress, and presently word would come that a tribe had been wiped off its ice field or the lights had gone out in Rome. With all the hopes our world is built on, they were utterly out of touch. They denied that the moon was Stilton. They denied she was even Dutch. They denied that wishes were horses, and they denied that a pig had wings. So we followed the gods of the market who promised us these beautiful things. When the Cambrian measures were forming, they promised perpetual peace. They swore if we gave them our weapons, the wars of the tribes would cease. But when we disarmed, they sold us and delivered us bound to our foe. And the gods of the copybook heading said, stick to the devil, you know. On the first feminine sandstones, we were promised the fuller life, which started by loving our neighbor and ended by loving his wife. Till our women had no more children and our men lost reason and faith. And the gods of the copybook heading said, the wages of sin is death. In the Carboniferous epoch, we were promised abundance for all by robbing selected Peter to pay for collective Paul. But though we had plenty of money, there was nothing our money could buy. And the gods of the copybook heading said, if you don't work, you die. Then the gods of the market tumbled, and their smooth-tongued wizards withdrew, and the hearts of the meanest were humbled and began to believe it was true. That all is not gold that glitters, and two makes four. And the gods of the copybook headings limped up to explain it once more. As it will be in the future, it was at the birth of man. There are only four things certain since social progress began. That a dog returns to his vomit, and that a sow returns to her mire, and the fool's burnt bandaged finger goes wobbling back to the fire. And after all this is accomplished and the brave new world begins, when all men are paid for existing and no man must pay for his sins, as surely as water will wet us and as surely as fire will burn, the gods of the copybook headings with terror and slaughter return. You cannot mock God and get away with it. You will reap what you have sown. It doesn't matter who you think you are, the strange and new. God is God, and we as Christians need to act like he is God and give him the position he deserves. There's an old saying, the saddest words of tongue or pen are these four words, what might have been. Don't let that be a testimony of your life. Don't waste the time God has given us. We do not know how much time is left, but we need to be faithful one day at a time. And you representatives, just do it for the Lord. Have the courage. If they get you out of there, let me tell you this, they will not get you out of there until he is done with you being there. I promise you that. He is the one that put you there, and he will keep you there as long as he wants you there. So do not fear the men. Those of you that aren't representatives, make sure you are praying for them every day for the courage to stand for the truth and the phone calls when they're doing something right. And you need to pray for your state, that God would have mercy on Oklahoma and that he would allow you, through your efforts, I know Pastor Paul, with 100 pastors you're getting together, 100 churches, that you, with God's blessing, would change the state of Oklahoma, which would domino through Texas and Louisiana and Alabama, and on it goes, and Tennessee. And who knows, maybe our grandkids will say, I cannot believe what God allowed our grandparents to do in changing the whole thing back to like God intended it to be. And so, but thank you so much for being here. I really appreciate it.